go, boys. How's it going?
Good.
Yeah. Can you hear me with us, mate?
Thanks for having me. Thanks, Joe.
Mark from Protect It. Let's do this. And what a beautiful day here. Guys, how exciting is this?
Very exciting.
Yeah, absolutely. Mark, it's so good to have you here in the car with us today, going for a drive in the beautiful Toyota Highlander. You know, here we are, we're out at Rosedale, going towards Mairangi Bay. Beautiful day. I can't think of a better way to start this podcast, to start this with yourself, Mark. So thanks for being here today.
Thanks for having me.
I kind of feel like it's Friday. The sun's out, we're near the beach.
We're at Mairangi Bay Beach with the head honcho in the car.
So I'm kind of thinking, look, we need to start this with a song, right? It's Friday, we got to kick this off with a song.
Absolutely.
So Mark, I got to ask you, if we're going to kick this off with a song, what is your jam? What's your favorite song right now?
Well, let's kick that off. I think on a beautiful day like today, it could only be the one and only Curtis Mayfield with Move On.
Oh, you're kidding me. That's the song that I have on my playlist ready to go. You ready?
Mate.
Let's do it. That must do it for you, mate.
It does.
So Mark, tell us, mate, who are you, mate? What makes you fire up? What makes you passionate about business and Protect It?
Well, I'm Mark, I'm a family man, local in Auckland, just really sort of with a background in sales and marketing, and then I moved into the building industry, and then through always wanting to do my own thing, be my own boss, create something tangible, I sort of looked at other avenues, other than building, getting off the tool, so to speak, and eventually came up with the idea of protecting surfaces in the building sector, so whether it be floors, bench tops, baths, vanities, glazing, joinery.
So tell us, Protect It, like what exactly do you do?
Basically what we do is we go on building sites throughout the greater Auckland area and we protect delicate surfaces. So it could be timber laminate floors, it could be your shower trays, it could be your bathtubs, it could be your beautiful granite stone bench tops. And also obviously your glazing and joinery, your aluminium joinery on the outside of your house.
So it's a great solution, right? You got monkeys on builder sites that that break stuff, mark stuff, scratch stuff, and you make sure that doesn't happen. You save people money, right?
Absolutely. And you know, sort of the all care, no responsibility seems to be sort of the way it was. I know a lot of guys are taking a lot more care now, obviously joinery and glazing being the most expensive component in a lot of builds. So yeah, it was a no-brainer for us to look at a business that could protect those for builders, save them time and money, through mitigating damage. So it was back in 2015 we wrote a business plan. I did a diploma in business, part of that was writing a business plan, and we looked at the surface protection, who our suppliers would be, how big the market was, and sort of the excitement of starting a business. And that's what I feel is the essential part of entrepreneurship, is the excitement of building something, finding a niche, doing your research, and then obviously the leap of faith. You know, the educated risk of jumping in the fry pan and starting a business, you know, leaving a secure job. I found it was the fear, but also the excitement. It's a love-hate. Yeah. And that's really what I found exciting, was the startup process.
Did you always have entrepreneurship in the blood?
Yeah, absolutely. Back when I was 12, I was cleaning mum's car often for pocket money. I was looking at options of, starting a little car cleaning business. I've always worked. Even at the age of sort of 8 or 9, I was stacking fridges at the local dairy.
Wow.
So I always knew the value of a dollar, and I knew it wasn't going to be given to me. So, if you want it, you got to go get it. So, always looking at options for doing my own business or doing something new and cool. So, always been in my blood, I guess.
Hey, tell us a little bit about your upbringing as well. And where were you raised? So you raised around the North Shore area?
Absolutely. I was born and bred down in sort of Devonport. So went to Devonport Primary. Obviously then did the Bellman Intermediate and Takapuna Grammar.
Flash into town, mate.
It wasn't so much back then. It was just a small town that sort of revolved around the Navy.
And, I was born up at Beach Haven, mate. So
is that right?
That was definitely the flash into town.
Hey, well, that's where I am now. So. good times. But yeah, always been sort of on the shore, love the shore. The shore's amazing. To me, I think honestly, it's probably one of the nicest places to live. New Zealand, you've got the city to go to, you've got the beaches, East Coast, can't beat it.
Yeah.
And it's amazing, so love it.
Mate, a lot of people don't make that leap of faith you talked about because it is a scary move. Do you remember that moment? And can you tell us some of the thoughts or the things that you did to kind of overcome that fear and kind of motivate yourself to kind of push past that barrier, which a lot of people just don't kind of push past, you know? That's why they're employed, right?
Yep, absolutely. Well, one thing I've always done is I've always drawn on experience around me. So whether it's my father, who's a bit of a real estate superstar,
cool.
He's always been a top salesman. So I sort of watched him growing up, how to talk to people, how to listen, more importantly.
Yeah.
Established really good relationships with his clients.
Yeah, that's a good one.
And also just people that I met, I always pick their brain, successful people. I've had the luxury of having some successful people in my life growing up. I always pick their brains, what were their key attributes and what are their daily habits that they do to be successful, to stay focused. But look, going, as you said, going into that scary moment, it was really just a matter of, it's now or never, making sure you've got your exit strategies in place. I mean, I could always go back to building. I could have always put the tool belt on. Didn't hate building at all. It was a great job. So I always knew I had a trade to go back to. So that kind of helped with things as well. My partner was working, so there wasn't a huge risk of financial ruin. And obviously backed myself and started up on the lean. So I didn't throw money into things that, a lot of people think the brand is the biggest thing, but it's actually, I think, just establishing core relationships with your clients and getting those policies and processes in place. A good accounting system, get a mentor, think about, expanding your in-house portfolio. So we started out doing glazing and joinery, and we're now doing floors, bench tops, toilets, glass, fireplaces, anything they don't want damaged. We've got a solution for. So growing your business from within in terms of your offerings and your services, and also backing yourself.
Man, that's incredible. Sounds like you've got your things down.
Well, you've got it down. No, I didn't in the start. In the start, like I said, it was really sort of flying by the seat of your pants.
Yeah.
You think you've got your business plan down, you know what you're doing, but to be honest, after a year, you may as well tear it up or rewrite it because your business changes that often
and
that
right.
quickly.
But you know what? The cool thing about that, Mark, is that a lot of businesses don't change, right? They get set on something and they go after it, and they're not actually listening to their clients.
No.
They're not listening to the demand of what people actually want. So your business should be changing. It should be different in a year's time.
Yep.
And we can think of many different brands that have gone under because they haven't made the change.
Yep.
So, how cool to be in a company like yours where you've got that culture of change.
Yep.
You're serving some pretty big brands, mate.
Yep.
Pretty reputable company, Protect It.
Yep.
Can you sort of tell us who you're sort of looking after out there?
Yeah, so we sort of, early on, we saw the benefit in establishing preferred agreements.
Mm-hmm.
So that means you're honouring a rate or a price and a service for a 12-month period. So we established agreements with Universal Homes, which was a huge builder here. We also got GJ Gardner, Jalcon, Fletcher Living. And a lot of these companies have obviously branches, South Auckland, East, West, North, and sort of once you get in, you create a good service, get a good relationship going, it sort of grows from there.
Fantastic. A lot of people they don't step into anything because they're waiting to find out what their passion is, right? And there'll be people watching now and they're going, man, but I don't know what my passion is, so I don't know when I'm gonna find out or find a way to live this quote-unquote successful life, or how am I gonna make the revenues or the profits or the impact that I've always dreamed that I could make, because they're not sure how to create that channel. From your story, you've obviously been raised in an environment and business, right?
Yep.
And you've cultivated that, you've worked hard at that. But I know that you've been involved in travel, you've been involved in building. There are seasons in life and there are different opportunities in life that can eventually lead somebody to an entirely new life or to new opportunities that can actually birth new dreams, right?
Yep.
So do you want to talk just a little bit about that? You know, your experience, your journey. Yep. What would you say to somebody who's just waiting on things because they're waiting for that passion thing to happen, then I'll take a move? What would you say to that person?
Just always be open. Always be open to an idea. No idea's too stupid or, seem silly. I know I had people sort of scratching their head when I said I wanted to put peelable coatings on glass. You know, how are you going to make money out of that?
Yeah.
You know, nothing's too silly. Do your due diligence, look, research what you want to do. Don't wait, because life does go so fast. You really just got to get in and do it.
Yeah.
Spend the time. It's going to take you, you're going to be working till 11 o'clock at night sometimes, but if you're passionate and you've got that excitement, for some reason you don't really get tired. You just sort of power on and do it. In terms of what you said, the industries I've worked in, every single one of those industries, I tap into what I learnt during that time now. So I may have not enjoyed the job, but the silver lining was I was learning about marketing, sales.
Yeah.
I was learning how to get in front of people, be at the coalface of your business, talking to your clients, establishing trust, listening, learning all those key sort of sales strategies and stuff. And then obviously into building, I learned, exactly what the guys on the ground are doing, the guys, who are physically building these things. So now I know when I talk to clients and builders, I know what they're talking about. I can relate to my client, and it's just proven valuable.
When I'm going through a moment or I'm in a role that I'm frustrated with, I always say to myself, you've got a choice as to how you can look at it. It's all perception, right? And are you looking at the short-term game or are you looking at the long-term game? And I think the short-term game says, why is this happening to me? This is difficult, this is tough. The long-term game, and the one that it seems that you have, is to ask the question, what can I learn out of this experience?
Yep.
Life doesn't happen to us. I think life happens for us. So what can I learn out of this experience? And so now you're doing everything that you're doing.
Yep.
You've picked up, just like you said, you've picked up how to learn how to listen, how to not just hear somebody, listen to somebody.
Yep.
You've learned how to sales and marketing and all these different elements, but they would never have come if you said, why is this happening to me? Rather, you asked a better question, what can I learn through this frustrating or long or lengthy, difficult season, right?
Yep, absolutely. And I think you can learn the most from your mistakes, from your worst experiences, you can sometimes learn the most.
There's this awesome quote that I've learned through business, and that is, certainty always wins over doubt. And as you say, you've got to back yourself, right? If you're certain and you're confident about who you are, what you're providing, and what you can do for your customers, your customers will believe you.
Absolutely.
Your staff will believe you.
Very true.
People that are listening to your advertising campaigns will believe you. You have to be certain about who you are, what you offer, what you can deliver. And I think when you are, then people will buy into that.
Yep, absolutely.
So obviously, the world has been working through COVID-19, and the game has changed, right? Business has changed. Business has had to evolve.
Yep.
So I wanted to ask you, this question, what would be your number one sales tip at the moment? Everyone's had, we've all had to sort of change how we do it, or not. You let us know, what is your number one sales tip at the moment?
Well, my number one sales tip, it's kind of a two-part thing, so excuse me, but obviously growing up, my father was a very good salesman, and he is all about relationships. Business is totally, solely based on relationships and trust. Now, the big part of that is being at the coalface of your business. So the number one tip I would say is don't try and sell through a keyboard or a monitor.
Wow.
Get out there, get in front of your clients, be at the coalface of your business.
Okay.
And ultimately, that's, if I was to give you a percentage, I'd say 90% of our business is from me walking in the walking onto site, seeing the clients, showing them what we do. Obviously, in a specialised coating business, which we are, it's a very tangible product. They need to see it working. So it's being in front of your clients, not sending that email to the info@. It's actually getting out there in front of your clients. This is who we are. This is what we do. Giving them your vision and your mission, and ultimately, they know who you are. You always want to deal with someone you've met and someone you're talking through a screen. So that the main thing was getting in front of your clients and establishing relations that way is definitely the number one thing.
Awesome. What would be your number one marketing tip at the moment?
Number one marketing tip for us at the moment is definitely literally through demonstration. I know that sounds probably how does that work, but usually through what we did. So in the early days, what I did when I was half building 1 week and doing protected the other half of the week when we were starting out, I literally had a little 600 by 600 window that I carried around in my car. I was constantly coating this thing every night. So every day I went out, I had this peelable coating on my window. So when I go to the cold calls and before you walk in, you get that slight of dread, am I going to be booed out of here? Which quite often you walk in, they're busy, they're working. Yeah, who's this traveling salesman, door-to-door salesman that's here? I had something tangible. So for us and what we do in terms of marketing, it was very much taking our physical product into the client and showing them what it was.
Great. The early days,
mate.
Hustling and going from builder's belt to Superman. Undies on and out there selling the product.
Yeah, so it was scary time, but like I said, it's exciting. And to be honest, if we hadn't done Protected, it would have been something else. You know, before Protected, I was trying to start up a website called Offcuts, and went through all that process again. Still learnt the process of building a business, but it wasn't to be. You know, you're never going to take on the big guys like Trabe and that. So we sort of canned that one. And it was sad to do that. I had so much hope for that. In the end, out of that came Protected.
Well, what would you say to the version of you that's just getting into business? If you give them one piece of advice.
Don't sweat the small stuff. Just concentrate, learn, listen. Feed on people around you, the experience of people around you. And just learn, listen, and just... You know, don't be too proud to ask questions, and just take your time, learn your industry, learn the processes, tap into any sources of knowledge around you, and just be good to your mother.
That's the best tip you've given us all day, mate. So Mark, obviously, a changing time for a lot of business out there with this whole COVID thing. Mate, what strategies did you put in place to get through?
Well, going into COVID, obviously a very uncertain time for everybody, but I was fortunate enough to go into it with a business advisor, a business coach, and she was pretty invaluable during that time. The biggest thing I found, the most important thing I found, was investing in your people. And obviously the guys, a lot of people were losing jobs around the place, so there's a lot of uncertainty. So when I said investing into my guys, during the lockdown we did resilience webinars. We also did a lot of brainstorming sessions. Life is so busy, the Monday to Friday, you don't really get a time to look at your business from the outside in. And the 4 weeks really allowed all the guys to get off the sites, go home, be with their families, but also look at the business. And we use that time to, first of all, plan. Secondly, look at how we can do things better, how we can streamline our processes, and just get thinking about the business and asking for their genuine input on how we can change things, so they feel they've got a say in the business.
Yeah.
So empowering the guys and investing in your guys, alleviating the uncertainty probably that they were feeling. I think that's held us in good stead for when we came out of lockdown, the guys are ready to go. We're talking about how can we increase our client base, how can we improve our systems, how can we do the job better, how can we, everything from we got a new van. How can we stack our product in there better to use? It was everything, and it was really much a 360 review on the business. So I thought it was actually a silver lining in a very uncertain time. So
it's been such a pleasure to have you on Carpool Honcho today, Mark.
Thanks,
we're so proud to be associated with Protected, and know that you're a great work out in the building industry, which is booming at the moment, and
it is,
much needed for you to be in there doing what you do. And so thank you, big thank you to the Toyota Small Business Driver Program for the use of this Highlander for the year. And of course, thanks to the Crate and the great community that we're a part of to be able to empower business during this amazing time. Let's make 2020 the best year. Yes,
absolutely.
So Mark, I know that there is another song coming from the 90s. I know that there's another song that you love. So what is that song?
That song, I've got a deep, deep love for Jamiroquai, and the song, the particular song in the 90s, the massive hit, could only be Virtual Insanity.
Oh no, here we go.
Oh,